In New York, Shepard Smith, Fox News.
All right, we gotta run. Look at this.
Today, we've had a national tragedy. Two airplanes have crashed into the World Trade Center in an apparent terrorist attack on our country. I have spoken to the Vice President, to the Governor of New York, to the Director of the FBI, and have ordered that the full resources of the federal government go to help the victims and their families. And to conduct a full-scale investigation to hunt down and to find those folks who committed this act.
September 11th, 2001, a day in America that will live in infamy.
An unimaginable horror. Four jetliners, all hijacked, three of them deliberately flown into major American landmarks. Thousands of people injured, thousands of people dead for sure. That death toll could reach four figures or perhaps even higher. It is 3 a.m. in the East, midnight in the West, and we're glad you're with us. I'm Rick Folbaum.
Thanks for joining us. I'm Laurie Dhue. Welcome to Fox News' continuing coverage of Terrorism Hits America. This is a multi-pronged story as we come to you at this hour. The FBI is looking into a possible link between these attacks and the international terrorist Osama bin Laden.
And the other part of the story is that rescue workers are mounting two massive efforts. They're sifting through the rubble at the destroyed World Trade Center Plaza in New York City and also the damaged Pentagon in Northern Virginia. And there are reports that some victims on the four hijacked airplanes made last-second goodbyes from their cell phones before those planes crashed. We begin our coverage this hour with David Lee Miller in downtown Manhattan, where the skyline there has been changed forever. David?
That's right, Rick, and so too have the lives of New Yorkers and in many ways Americans as well. Now, a massive search and rescue effort is now underway at this hour. The authorities say as many as 2,000 searchers are taking part. We expect that it's really going to begin in earnest when dawn begins. We have some new pictures to show you. Now, these are unedited pictures. They are raw pictures, but they are important to see. They were recorded just a short time ago, and they were taped right near the World Trade Tower, what was once that site, near New York's West Side Highway. And here you can see the fallen debris. You can see a footbridge over the highway that has collapsed. You can see the ground covered with white ash. It looks almost like a dusting of heavy snow, and you can also see the remnants of some of the people who fled the scene and perhaps died in this horrible, vicious attack. Now, we also have some live pictures we can show you, which are tell you what is unfolding now about the six blocks behind me here on Church Street in Lower Manhattan. This is the scene now where rescue workers are beginning their operation. The authorities believe that thousands of people are now buried under once what was the World Trade Center, not known how many of them might be alive. The mayor of New York, Mayor Giuliani, has said that at least two people trapped under the rubble were able to call their family in Seattle. So definitely people are alive. How many, we do not know. It's really going to be a race against the clock to get them out. All but certain now they're going to be bringing in sniffer dogs, acoustical equipment to try and detect the people that are buried. But as I mentioned, it's not clear how badly they are hurt or how much longer they can last. The mayor said it's going to take at least a few days before we can get some type of clear estimate as to exactly how many people have actually been killed. And as for the scene right now in Lower Manhattan, as you can tell, the electricity is off here. The authorities have turned it off. They have disconnected the gas in order to prevent the possibility of explosions or further fire. And the lights you do see are provided by batteries or generators. It almost makes for a very surreal setting. But as dawn approaches, the search itself is going to begin in earnest, as I said. And at that time, we expect that some of the officials here are going to start to make some very gruesome discoveries. Back to you in the studio.
All right, David Lee Miller, thanks very much, David, as we continue to look at some live pictures of the devastation. A lot of the injured are being treated at a nearby hospital, New York's Saint Vincents Hospital.
Dari Alexander has been there all night. She joins us again with the latest. Dari.
Hey, Lori. You know, once again, we, along with hospital workers, are playing the waiting game. We haven't seen any EMS trucks come up here anytime soon. And I guess, you know, as David was talking about it, it takes quite a while for them to get through all of that rubble. I know that because David is a journalist and they pushed a lot of people back pretty far, it's hard perhaps to get somewhat of a perspective on what's going on. But I'm standing here with Rafael de la Piña, who is a reserve member of the National Guard. He was out there early this morning between the plane strikes. So he was there after the first, helping recover, helping some of the people, and was there when it happened. And I was talking with Rafael earlier, asking him to give me a little bit of a perspective of what this rubble looks like so we can understand exactly how long and what has to be done to really get those people out, those people we're hoping that are still alive. And you heard also the report that people were calling.
Yes, on the cellular phones. Yeah, that gives us a lot of hope, especially for people like me that were there from the very early of the disaster. And we saw actually people jumping through the windows, people falling, the actual two towers collapse. The third tower collapsed, the number seven. And we could only do the first phase of the search and rescue, which is not moving any debris, just with the dogs. But after that, there was getting too dark, and they told us that it was over. So they now have to bring the big trucks to move the debris. Then we received the news that they're activating another 50 ambulances here, because there's people calling from cellular phones inside the debris.
Now that is certainly, we're very happy to hear that. I know that you and I talked about the fact that what we don't want to talk about is what you saw immediately after the blast, you know, the bodies, all of that stuff. But help me out here. Describe to me, you talked about like a two-story high pile of debris. I mean, help us understand how you get people out of all of that. I mean, because that's obviously what we're waiting for, those people who are alive under there.
Well, the sensation that we get from the actual activity of rescuing, it could be overcome by the fear of another explosion. See, when you're walking in top of this debris trying to get people out, you're also scared because you don't know if it's going to explode again. And what we did is the most we could, moving debris that was little, and actually, you know, try not to hurt people more.
That's right.
Because that's why they can use trucks until we finish. When we finish, that's when the big trucks come in. They actually gave up at that point, and they were just moving big debris when they started hearing people calling. So this is like a renewal of the spirit of going back again, which I'm going back again next morning to continue doing the search and rescue.
Now, describe to me, though, the huge chunks of debris. I mean, a lot to move down there, right?
Okay, first, if you want, I could tell you, actually, when it fell down, that's the whole thing. When it fell down, you saw the cloud of smoke, and you could not see if the actual debris was coming on top of you. You just saw the cloud coming on top of you. So you're running thinking that something is going to hit you.
Right.
So when you come back, you actually expect to see the debris all over. And it was neatly in top of a pile, like I would say, like almost two blocks. And it was two-story or almost three-story high. Okay. The pieces of debris were not small.
Okay.
But some of it became sand. Some of the, what do you call it?
The debris, little spectacles.
They became sand. So it make it harder for us to see and breathe inside of the actual zone.
Well, you were certainly one of the lucky ones that definitely got out of there. And as we reported to you earlier, about 45 rescue workers did come through this hospital. One firefighter did die. But once again, as you just heard Rafael say, a high spirit. They had to reassess at 5:30, figure out what they could do. But once again, they have a high spirit again, went back down there, and Rafael will be back down there tomorrow, hoping once again to find some more people that they can bring up here and treat. That's what's happening here outside of St. Vincent's Hospital. Back to you guys.
All right, Dari Alexander at St. Vincent's, thanks very much. Well, one question looms in the minds of Americans. Who is responsible? Well, possible suspects are emerging in this terrorist attack.
And Fox's Todd Connor is live now from Fox Central with this late-breaking story. Todd?
That's right, Rick and Laurie. As you know, the newspaper is starting to hit the newsstands this morning, and one of the stories from the Boston Herald has apparently led police to, or the story is about police, finding some possible suspects out of Logan International Airport in Boston. The story goes that authorities in Massachusetts have identified at least five Arab men as suspects. They launched from Logan International Airport. Police seized in the central parking garage a car filled with Arabic language flight training manuals, according to the source for the Boston Herald. Now, two of the men whose passports were traced to United Arab Emirates were brothers, one of whom was a trained pilot, according to this source. Now, at least two other suspects flew into Logan yesterday from Portland, Maine, where authorities believe they had traveled to after crossing over from Canada. Once in the air, according to this source of the Boston Herald, the hijackers in one of the two planes that left Boston that hit the Twin Towers began killing flight attendants in order to lure a pilot out of the cockpit and then take over the plane. They started killing stewardesses in the back of a plane as a diversion. The pilot came back to help, and that is how they got into the cockpit, according to the source. The suspects apparently had no guns, but used shaving kits and other carry-on luggage to smuggle knife-like weapons made up of plastic handles with razor blades inserted into those handles. That's what they used as their weapons, according to this source for the Boston Herald. People were calling the plane, as we've heard many reports, you two have reported, saying they were going to die. They were calling 911. In fact, one stewardess called her husband to say goodbye. Now, how did the authorities find this rental car in the first place? It's believed they were led to the rental car by a civilian who got into an altercation, he says, with several Arab men as they were parking their car. This man had gotten onto a flight, flew to his location, and it wasn't until he got off his flight yesterday and heard the news about the plane crashes and the hijacking that this came back to him about his altercation with these gentlemen in this parking garage. Well, he called authorities, and authorities traced his story back to this car, and that's how they found this car at Logan International Airport. Again, just to recap, this car apparently filled with Arabic language flight training manuals, and they found some passports, apparently, according to this story in the Boston Herald, and one of those passports belongs to a gentleman from the United Arab Emirates who is a trained pilot. Whether these men are really suspects in this or not, I'm sure we'll find out in the days to come, but that's the latest story hitting the newsstands this morning in the Boston Herald. Laurie and Rick, back to you.
Todd Connor from Fox Central, thanks very much. And, of course, we'll keep you posted on any developments regarding that story. But now we want to give you a recap of the tragic events of today. At 9:31 a.m., after the two hijacked planes smashed into the World Trade Center, President Bush, who was in Florida, calls the crashes an apparent attack on our country, an apparent terrorist attack on our country. At 9:40 a.m., American Airlines Flight 77, carrying 64 people from Washington to Los Angeles, crashes into the Pentagon. At 9:48 a.m., the Capitol and the West Wing of the White House are evacuated. Immediately after, the FAA bars aircraft takeoffs across the country in an unprecedented act. International flights in progress are told to land in Canada. At 10 a.m., United Flight 93 crashes 80 miles southeast of Pittsburgh. Between 10 a.m. and 11:30 a.m., government buildings across the country are evacuated, including the Capitol and the White House. At 11:40 a.m., President Bush arrives at Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana. About 2 hours later, the president leaves Barksdale for a secure, undisclosed location. At 2:51 p.m., the Navy dispatches missile destroyers and other equipment to both New York and Washington. At 7 p.m., President Bush arrives in Washington from Nebraska. We want to take a closer look now at what has been happening in New York as we look at live pictures of what is left of the World Trade Center towers.
It started just before 9 a.m. Eastern time with word that a plane had crashed into one tower of New York's World Trade Center. It could have been an accident until this.
We just saw another one. We just saw another one. Another plane just flew into the second tower. This raises, this has to be deliberate, folks.
And Americans watched in shock as a second jetliner flew straight into the second tower.